And now the lion. We go on the stage every night with the same feeling. We are afraid. And if somebody tell you this, tell you who is not afraid, this mean is a liar. My father was a baker. One thing I did do well was football. I was a member of the local team, but not one of the best. Because I was a football fan, then I did like very much to play football until 8 o'clock in the night when the sun go down.
I will not make this observation if I understand is impossible to do. Mm-hmm. It is not going to take tonight if you. If you can't do this tonight like that, I walk away.
I was watching an old interview and it was fascinating listening to how humble he was, because he had a reputation or there was a sort of aura around him of being a very difficult and egocentric singer, which I don't think he was at all. I think he was saying how frightened he was. He said he was like a child before a performance, and how he had no faith in himself, and how he used to tell himself he was going to crash.
Fantastic.
He was going to be unmistakable because he was so huge.
Mr. Pavarotti, speaking on behalf of all the ladies in the audience, we should like you to know that we love large men, and particularly... especially large men with large voices. Do you think that your huggable extra inches helps to produce that beautiful resonance?
I think so.
He realized here was a new public and he valued that very much. And when he gave interviews and so on, he played the game beautifully.
The people, then they say that they are fat because help singing, I think they are lying to themselves. So when I'm coming back in a couple of years, you will not recognize me.
And the public adored him. And in a way, quite rightly so, because he was a charming personality, very, very genial.
Luciano Pavarotti suggested he wanted to dive in. So in the press conference afterwards, I asked the tenor, famed for his waistline and enormous appetite, why he hadn't brought his swimming trunks.
Provocative.
So, would he like to borrow some?
One of the wonderful things about your voice is your gift for pitch. Is that something you just had, or did you develop
it's
it?
It's something that I am crazy about. When I make a record, I drive everybody nuts, because they say, no, it is not in the right pitch. I remember during Bohème, with Maestro Karajan, we made Cagliari da Manina, and at a certain point, there is an harp, then it plays, Asci riscaldare, cercare, che giova, buio, non si trova, dun, 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 dun. My ear, the harp was flat. At the end of the session, we were rushing and watching the thing that we had to redo. And the maestro did not mention that little thing. They did not give him
And the harp was flat?
And the harp was flat.
Uh-huh. You were right.
Oh, yes. No doubt about that.
He was very interested in his high notes, and he always wanted Decca to record his high notes before he sang anything else, which I found I didn't like that very much. But and he wanted to hear his own voice louder than anybody else's. So in the control room, I used to say to Decca, turn him up, turn the others down, then he'll be happy, and he was.
There was always the problem, I cannot hear my voice. But I mean that, I've never known a tenor not have that particular problem, and there were ways of helping him. If he felt that he wasn't in his best voice, we used to feed him with the most wonderful little capsules. I have to show you. Meloids, unfortunately, now are banned because they contain too much menthol. But they were absolutely fine, and he had them by the fistful. But he insisted on calling them melodies, melodies. And so if anybody chose to produce them again, I am sure they would advertise them as used by Pavarotti and become millionaires.
Having the opportunity to meet John Sutherland for me in at the age of 29 in Australia was quite remarkable, and it was probably the greatest help technically in my life. And I spied this beautiful diaphragm every night when we were singing together, and I did learn a lot.
What actually did you learn from John Sutherland?
I learned to breathe, how to breathe for singing. Under control, because before I was breathing normally and instinctively. If it means that if one night I was well, feeling well physically, I was even singing well. The following night, not feeling well, you don't know how to order to your diaphragm to go up and down, because of course when you are scared, you become paralyzed. Instead, the diaphragm still must go up and down, up and down.
One of Pavarotti's favourite roles was the country bumpkin, Nemorino, in Donizetti's L'Elisir d'Amore.
The handkerchief begin when I begin to make my recital in 1973. Like you can imagine, a tenor going out in front of people without a set doesn't know what to do with the hand.
Of course.
So I try in front of the mirror many positions, and I did not like any of them. So I took the handkerchief in one hand, the handkerchief in the other. So now we go out and we stay like that. And I begin like that, and the expression on the face become very good. It was impossible. It was very concentrated. And after a while, I was more and more relaxed, until now I think he's my partner. I cannot stay without.
You can't go on without the hanky.
No.
Yeah.
When you're of such a standard as Pavarotti, you have the world watching everything you do.
Luciano Pavarotti, I say to all of you, goodbye soon, arrivederci, ciao.